The racism that is aimed at Aboriginal people is an historical one.
The sad thing about it, we never had names, we had numbers.
They're still taking our kids, they're still taking our land. They still want us to assimilate. It won't happen.
How do you change that?
I don't think it'll change, the racism will be around till they're all going back to England.
The same historical understanding is still there. The Aborigine is the enemy of society.
I was born in an Aboriginal mission. We never had names, we had numbers.
I was taken from my mother at the age of 2.
You can be told about it, but you can't take it back. You can't take it back. It's gone. I can sit here and relate to you case after case after case of where the police and or jail officers killed people and then covered it up.
What was our life worth? Nothing. We're at a place called Perfleet Mission. It's situated about 3 kilometres from the main town in Taree on the mid-north coast of New South Wales. We're standing on the ground of my people, the Biripi people, and I was born over the back of this mission in 1948. This place, a lot of memories, and I love it very much. As the old people tell me, my mother and my grandparents, I was born in 1948. But my mother being 16, and the Aboriginal Protection Board were around then. So she was constantly on the run from the Aboriginal Protection Board. And she never registered me till a year later, 1949. Yeah. Around Taree we lived off bush food and the sea and the river, yeah. So pretty healthy, and until we was put on rations. People put on rations, a bit of flour, sugar and all that. So it changed our lifestyle with it. Other than the manager being there, I mean, he controlled everything, so. Didn't have much say. You're only allowed in the town a certain hour. But I had a good upbringing from a lot of elders there, so, you know, they let us through wisely, so, yeah. But it wasn't until in January, in 57, I think it was, that these blokes in suits come there to the door. And they were the Aboriginal Protection Board. I was 9 years old. It was exactly platform 1 here. This is the North Coast line, which went to Kempsey. Behind you. Over this way. And behind me, a couple of platforms back, was the South Coast line, where my brother and sister were taken to Cootamundra, yes.
And that was my first encounter with the police.
My mother, that's what I remember. I remember her as when I left Central. You know, a young woman. And this was a few years she had us, that's 3, before we got sent away. But otherwise, yeah, Mum's gone now. She's been dead for a while. I think she died from broken heart, really. The racism around then, back in them days, you know, you can imagine. I never seen my sister till I turned 50. We were separated that long, you know, so we really never got to know each other, so, you know. My brother Les, he lives in Brisbane now. And the police dropped us off at this institution, Kinsella Boys Army. It was about 40 miles out of the main town, on the river, on the Maclay River. The river was just across the road from the Boys Army. But it was a 32-acre farm, you know, and without a school, 2 dormitories, you know, and we all had jobs. But the sad thing about it, we never had names, we had numbers. Traumatizing experience, but sometimes good, you know. But all we had was each other, the boys. We were all families. That's me there. Couldn't even talk to our own people. When we go to school, what they used to call the mission blacks. They lived on reserves. See, we were under the Aboriginal protection thing, so we was like, if we were white. That's what one of the main punishments in the boys, and when you landed there, they drummed in the head that you were white. Mm. You know, so, yeah, very sad thing, really. But it happened, you know, it's fact.
The governments of this country actively took Aboriginal children from their parents and changed their names and put them out to other people. There are still people out there who can't find their families, and there are still those out there who don't even know about their Aboriginal heritage. My earliest memory is I must have been about 4 or 5 with my adopted family. Prior to that, I have no recollections. Now, my mother, my adopted mother, she was very strong that I, and especially the government, were not to know that I was of Aboriginal background. Otherwise, they could take me again. It was only in my mid-30s that I found out about the Aboriginal side. But she wouldn't give me any names. I was told that my mother, my birth mother, came from Orange, which is over the mountains. And I've been to Orange, and I've tried to find people, Aboriginal people, who might know something, but they don't know anything. They don't know anything. It's very, very difficult when you don't have names. So I've just got to let it go. And like, I mean, I'm 72 now, so I don't know how much longer I'm here, whether it's 1 year or 10 years or what bloody ever. But without names, you're gone. The stolen generations that were apologised to by Rudd still have that trauma, still have that biting need to know if they don't know their family. They have the pain of being taken from their family, not just their birth mother or father, but their family, their community, their culture, the whole thing.
It's time to reconcile. It's time to recognise the injustices of the past. It's time to say sorry. It's time to move forward together. As Prime Minister of Australia, I am sorry. On behalf of the Government of Australia, I am sorry. On behalf of the Parliament of Australia, I am sorry. And I offer you this apology without qualification. I know that in offering this apology on behalf of the Government and the Parliament, there is nothing I can say today that can take away the pain you have suffered personally. Whatever words I speak today, I cannot undo that. Words alone are not that powerful. But my proposal is this. If the apology we extend today is accepted in the spirit of reconciliation in which it is offered, we can today resolve together that there be a new beginning for Australia. And it is to such a new beginning that I believe the nation is now calling us.
So there are still out there now a lot of grandmothers, a lot of aunts and uncles who, having got over the puff piece that Rudd done, and the crowd felt good on that day, but yesterday, tomorrow, there is no difference to your lifestyle. There is no difference to what you go through every bloody day. The police don't stop knocking on your door. Racism doesn't stop. not enough. And I'm not talking about compensation. I'm talking about the apology for what had been done to the mobs in this country, the traditional owners. It's more than just the stolen generations. It's more than that. I think a greater apology was Paul Keating's Redfern Park speech. Paul Keating totally outlined the errors that had been done to the Aboriginal people from the time that the invaders first came here in 1788 up to the present day.
The starting point might be to recognise that the problem starts with us, the non-Aboriginal Australians. It begins, I think, with an act of recognition. Recognition that it was we who did the dispossessing. We took the traditional lands and smashed the traditional way of life. We brought the diseases and the alcohol. We committed the murders. We took the children from their mothers. We practiced discrimination and exclusion. It was our ignorance and our prejudice and our failure to imagine that these things could be done to us.
It encompasses much more than just the stolen kids. It's much more than that. There were stolen wages, there were stolen land, there were stolen everything.
Racism you can find everywhere, I think. So Australia in that sense is not unique, but there are versions of racism that in Australia are quite historically specific to this country. To go back to how Australia was originally settled, it was Aboriginal land to begin with, and about 200 years ago, more than 200 years ago, it was settled by the British. But the Europeans became the dominant group in this country. It's a settler colonial country, right? So I think the notion of settler colonialism is really important, that structurally Australia is a country that was settled by people from outside who came here to displace the original inhabitants, which were the Aborigines. And Australia became an independent nation in 1901. It was very much the design of the people in charge of that process that this would be a white outpost in an alien region. So the White Australia policy, which was established then, was very much foundational for Australia as a modern nation state. Racism was, in that sense, structurally embedded in the very foundation of Australia as a nation state.
When we look at history, and we need to do that, going back to 1788, they brought the convicts out. They brought the troopers to look after the convicts and to settle any other problems. Now, over time, the troopers turned into doing acts that they called clearing the lands, which means killing our people. That ethos of the troopers, of treating Aboriginal people as some sort of flora or fauna, is still in the minds of the police today, because the police was born out of the troopers. The troopers became the police. And that same ethos, that same historical understanding is still there. The Aborigine is the enemy of society. They want things. They want their land, they want rights, they want this, they want, and why should they have it? We won. That's the attitude.
It happened back, still happening, you know, with our people. The coppers, they, as I say, divide and rule, law. It's still embedded in no matter how many generations you go through, you know, white Australians.
Any police officer in this country can kill. They know that. They could kill me when I go downstairs to the shop. They will then turn around and say that I attacked them with a knife, but the knife's lost. The knife can't be found. And because it's police who are investigating other coppers, that's the truth. Ray Jackson had a knife and he attacked me. I had to shoot him to defend myself. That is their power. And the governments allow them to get away with it. The police in this country can kill with impunity and immunity. That is their power. And they're backed up by government.
I mean that we don't recognise their sovereignty at all. This is our sovereignty and it always was and always will be.
I was asked a question at a doorstop yesterday morning and I made the point that a lot's happened in 40 years and I think we have moved on from the issues of 40 years ago, which caused the Aboriginal Tent Embassy to be set up.
How do you change that? I've been involved in death and custody issues since 1987. A damned long time. And I don't mean just going on a few marches a year. I mean everyday active. Anybody who comes to a meeting, as far as I'm concerned, is a member of ISCA. If they want to stand with those involved with ISCA, then consider yourself a bloody member. The situation now with deaths in custody is, yes, ISCA is getting involved. We're doing the marches, we're doing the protests, the public meetings. We're doing things. We have a constitution that is very much an English racist constitution. I don't call it the Australian Constitution at all. I call it the English, because that's what it's based on. And for many, many years, the Aborigines were forced off their lands, were forced into missions, their wages were stolen, their kids were stolen, everything was done under the letter of the law. Since the end of May 1989, up to the present day, there's been over 300 more deaths in custody. There's a death in custody about one a month. So every month there's a death in custody, either at the hands of the police or in jails. That's national. That is national.
And we want to get rid of the intervention laws. We've got to demand that the intervention laws.